job with it. Now, Xerxes. Who is this guy, Xerxes? Xerxes starts at about 486, goes down to about 465. You see about 20, 21 years there. And I want to, the acrostic I use for him is BEG 300, BEG 300. Basically, he's a son of Darius who is groomed for the job. Babylon rebels. So his first thing is that Babylon rebels here. And what does Xerxes do? He takes the Bel Marduk statue of their god and melts it down. Okay, he takes the gold statue of Bel Marduk and he melts the statue down. Again, do you see how that really violates these people? This is their major god. He melts it down. It just shows kind of he's in your face. He doesn't respect them and he takes it down. So that's Xerxes. I want to say Xerxes is a Jerxes. That's how I do him. Xerxes is a Jerxes. He's a jerk kind of person. He turns out he's Esther's husband. The book of Esther, this is the guy with Esther. You remember that Xerxes had his wife Vashti come out. Rumor has it, Dr. Phillips and others think that Vashti, the queen, was told to come out into a party with nothing on but a crown on her head. And Vashti says, I'm not going out there like that. And Xerxes says, well, then you aren't going to be my queen. And so then he searches the empire and finds Esther. Esther becomes his queen, and you have the book of Esther taking place. Xerxes was Esther's husband. He's a jerk. Xerxes was a Xerxes, but he did spare the Jews. After Haman and things tried to kill the Jews, Xerxes actually gives a decree to spare the Jews in the book of Esther. And so for such a time as this, Esther happens, and that's Esther's husband. He goes to Greeks. Xerxes actually makes it to Greece. He goes to Athens, and he's going to torch Athens. So he's going to burn the place down. He isn't strong enough to really hold the territory, so he basically just burns it down, and then he's going to take back off and things like that. He actually loses his battle at Salamis and things, and so he's Xerxes makes it to Greece, but he has some problems making it there. When he does make it there, he burns it down. In the Battle of Salamis in 480 BC, the Greeks won and the Persians retreated. At the Battle of Thermopylae, you get 300 Spartans holding off thousands and thousands of Persians. They were in this very narrow pass, and the 300 Spartans held off and stood up to Xerxes' thousands. And it just shows the great warriorness of the Spartans, and that gave them, slowed the Persians down, that gave the Greeks time to rally their forces to oppose Xerxes. And so the 300, there's a movie, not saying I recommend it, my son forced me to go see it, but the movie 300 actually narrates that battle and things and stuff. There's some good parts and bad parts in that movie, I should just tell you up front. So this is Xerxes. Xerxes attacks Greece, torches Greece, fights with Greece, and Esther, Xerxes is Esther's husband. Now, Artaxerxes is during the time of the Ezra and Nehemiah. Nehemiah is cupbearer. Nehemiah is the cupbearer of Artaxerxes. So in the Bible, when you read the story of Nehemiah, Nehemiah is a wonderful book about leadership. And the leadership, if you're interested in leadership principles, there's a guy named Jack Murray, who, if you go to my website, he's got 5 lectures on leadership out of the book of Nehemiah. It's a great book for leadership. Nehemiah was a leader. He was a cupbearer for King Artaxerxes. And Nehemiah is the wall builder. When Nehemiah goes to Jerusalem now, he is going to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. He's going to do it at night and some really cool stuff there. But Nehemiah is the wall builder in Jerusalem. So now Jerusalem has got a temple finished under Darius, but it needs a walls to protect it. Nehemiah is going to build the walls of Jerusalem under Artaxerxes, and so Nehemiah is the wall builder. Egypt revolts at this time, and he will put that down, and it had helps of the Greeks. So what you see is the Greeks over in the west and Egypt kind of uniting, pushing back on the Persian Empire. So you'll notice regionally how the people in the west push back on the people of the east. The people of the east push over to the people in the west. So there's some kind of some geography behind that as well. Ezra returns as a scribe and priest. And so you've got that kind of thing going down. Now, after Artaxerxes, I just want to say, basically, the Persian Empire is going to deconstruct. It's going to basically disintegrate. And so these last guys are really totally unimportant and things. But Darius II, what he does is he sets up these Peloponnesian Wars. And what are the Peloponnesian Wars? Do you remember we showed you a picture of Greece that Athens was north and Achaia and Sparta was south on the Peloponnese? And what happens is Sparta fights with Athens and Athens fights with Sparta. And so these two, they're both Greeks and stuff, but they fighting within themselves, kind of like an American Civil War, the north versus the south. And so Sparta's in the south. The Spartans are warriors. The Athenians are more your philosopher types, but they have warriors as well, and they'll go back and forth. Now, when the Spartans start winning, who will the Persians support? When the Spartans start winning, then the Persians would support Athens, and so Athens would come up. When Athens started defeating Sparta, then the Persians would support Sparta, and Sparta would. And so what the Persians did was they kept them at war. They would support the loser so that whoever was a loser would come up, and they would keep fighting each other, killing each other. Kind of sounds like American policy in some ways. We always support the loser and the people go on fighting and things. And so Persia purposely kept the Greeks fighting. By the way, if you keep them fighting against themselves, then they can't fight against you. So there's some strategy there. But the Peloponnesian Wars happens during this period, and the Persians are supporting the battle between Athens and Sparta during this time. This is right around 400 BC. This is about the time that the Old Testament Malachi is ending in the Judaism. Here's a wonderful book by Xenophon called The Anabasis. The Anabasis was written by Xenophon. He was a Greek historian. And he basically tells the story of basically 10,000, 11,000 of these Greek mercenaries who hired themselves out. The Greeks were mercenaries. They hired themselves out to the Persians to go fight the battles for one of the kings that was basically there was a power struggle in the Persian Empire. And so he hired these 10,000 Greeks because the Greeks were known to be great warriors. So these Greek warriors come over and they're fighting for this guy. I think his name was Cyrus, somebody of the third or fourth or whatever. And they fight for this guy, but then the guy ends up getting killed. So now you've got all these 10,000 Greeks in the middle of Mesopotamia over by Babylon. Well, what do the Greeks want to do? The Greeks want to go home. So what the story of the Anabasis is, tells the heroic tales, and that this is apparently one of the great stories of the ancient world, these 10,000 Greek warriors as they fight their way home, going back from Mesopotamia, from being mercenaries to the Persians, back to Greece. And the Anabasis by Xenophon tells their story of how they come back to Greece and things. This is a kind of a heroic tale. One of the great heroic tales coming out of the Greeks and with the Persians in that regard. Darius III is the end of the Persian Empire. And largely, this Darius III guy will end up banging heads with Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great, or Alexander the Grape as I call him, Alexander the Great will fight Darius III and defeat him and trounce him. And so this is when Alexander, we said before, Alexander's date was what? Half of 666, Alexander's date is 333. 333 BC, Alexander takes over. So the Persians run largely from about 500 down to about 300. You had about 200 years of Persian rule, and then with 333, Alexander is going to go through and he's going to conquer the whole Persian Empire. And pay them back for all the, you know, they've been, you know, agitating in Greece for years. Alexander will kind of put it back in their face. Okay.
This is Dr. Ted Hildebrandt teaching his New Testament History, Literature, and Theology course, Lecture Number 1, Introduction to the Course and the History of the Persian Empire, up to the time of Alexander.